Thanks to the Great Courses Plus for supporting PBS. They say that a watched pot never boils. This has now been proven true by quantum mechanics. A moving arrow is at rest. This is obviously a nonsensical contradiction, but Zeno, Greek philosopher famous for his metaphysical trolling, devised a paradox whose conclusion is just this. Here's how it goes. If you look at an arrow flying through the air at any instantaneous snapshot in time, the arrow doesn't travel any distance. If time is composed of an infinite number of these snapshots, and the arrow doesn't move in any of them, then the arrow is at rest during the entirety of its flight. The moving arrow is at rest. Nowadays, most physicists and mathematicians don't really see Zeno's arrow as paradoxical. We think of an instant as a vanishingly small interval of time. Then during that time, the moving arrow travels a vanishingly small distance. But the vanishingly small part cancels out, and the arrow's instantaneous velocity is very real. That's what a mathematician might tell you. But quantum mechanics also has a thing or two to say about extremely tiny distances and time intervals. In fact, if we're talking about a quantum arrow, there may be a way to freeze its motion simply by looking at it through the aptly named quantum Zeno effect. The quantum Zeno effect predicts that certain quantum events, like the electrons moving between atomic energy levels or the decay of atomic nuclei, can be frozen through the simple act of observation. I'm going to tell you about some very real experiments that claim to have demonstrated this phenomenon. But first, let's see if the quantum Zeno effect can save us from being shot by a quantum arrow. First, we'll give our arrow a few weird behaviors befitting a good quantum object. We have quantization. Certain properties of our arrow can only take on specific discrete values, like how an electron can only occupy certain energy states in an atom. In this case, let's say our quantum arrow's position is quantized. It can exist only at the start and end of its path, but not in between. In order to travel from start to end, it has to flick between these states without occupying the intervening space. One way to do that is by executing a quantum jump, which we discussed in our recent episode. Okay, the next quantum property we need is superposition. Just like Schrodinger's cat, our quantum arrow can exist in multiple states at once. That means it can be at the start and end of its path simultaneously. It could be a 50-50 split between the two, or 25% in one, 75% in the other, etc. Now, you never actually see it in both states at once. Rather, each state has an amplitude that determines the probability of finding the arrow in that state were you to try to observe it. In the language of the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics, we say that the wavefunction collapses on observation. Prior to that observation, the arrow exists just as the distribution of probability amplitudes of its position. Its wave function is spread between the start and end of its trajectory. But after observation, it collapses to definitely one or the other, at least according to Copenhagen, and we'll be coming back to this craziness later. This superposition thing actually gives our quantum arrow a way to travel its path smoothly and gradually, but still without occupying the space in between. And maybe for us, it gives us a way to save ourselves in the end. Here's the scenario. Someone shoots a quantum arrow at you. It begins in the pure state of being entirely at the start of its journey, but then it enters a superposition of states, mostly at the start, but also a little bit at the end. Now, if you observe the arrow now, most likely it will collapse back to the starting position, but there's a small chance it would suddenly appear in the final state, having reached you. But if there is no observation, the wave function evolves. Less and less amplitude at the starting state and more at the end, until it finally enters the pure state of definitely hitting you. Two ways this can play out. The arrow leaves the quantum bow with a quantum twang. In shock, you close your eyes, just for a second, which is your mistake. It allows the arrow's wave function to evolve smoothly into a state of quantum ouch. But what if you keep your eyes open? Every observation you make of the arrow collapses its wave function into one of its possible positions, start or end, but because you start watching it close to the beginning of its journey, there's very little probability of it collapsing to the end. Your observation resets the trajectory to the start, at which point the wave function has to start evolving from scratch, but you keep observing, and it keeps resetting back again through the magic of the quantum Zeno effect. So the message is clear. If anyone ever tries to shoot you with a quantum arrow, don't blink. Of course, arrows don't really behave this way, but it seems that this is exactly what real quantum systems should do. If a system can occupy two discrete states and transition between those states, that transition can be halted if you continuously measure the state. Again, in theory. This has actually been tested for electron transitions in atoms, and I'll tell you about the experiments in a minute, but in principle, this would also work for radioactive decay, even chemical reactions. The basic idea of the quantum Zeno effect was first proposed by Alan Turing, but it got a full theoretical description in the 1970s. And then in 1990, a group of scientists headed up by David Wineland and Wayne Itano claimed to have demonstrated it in an experiment by halting electron energy transitions. These were some of the same people who first demonstrated quantum jumps using a similar scheme that we described in that episode. To recap, we have a collection of laser-cooled atoms in an electromagnetic trap. A constant radio frequency field is tuned to cause the electrons to oscillate smoothly between two energy levels. Call them 1 and 2. Just like our quantum arrow, sometimes the electron is in state 1, sometimes it is in state 2, but in between it's a smoothly varying superposition of both. Next, they flash the atoms with a laser, whose frequency matches the energy difference between state 1 and a new state, state 3. If the electron is in state 1 when the laser pulse hits, it absorbs a laser photon and jumps to 3, and then immediately drops back down to 1, releasing the energy as a new photon that the researchers can detect. So the atoms glow during these laser pulses. On the other hand, if the atom is in a state 2 during the pulse, it would not absorb a photon and the atom would stay dark. But what if the laser hits while the electron is in the middle of a transition, in a superposition of states 1 and 2? Well, according to the Wavefunction Collapse picture, it has to make a choice. The superposition must vanish and the electron will be seen in either state 1 or state 2. According to the researchers, the laser acts like a measurement. And remember, measurement should be able to freeze quantum arrows and presumably also electron transitions via the quantum Zeno effect. To test this, the researchers start all the atoms in state 1 and then hit them with a series of very rapid laser pulses. In theory, these measurements are fast enough that they should stop the wave function from evolving. And they report that it did exactly this. The faster the chain of pulses, the more likely that the atoms remained in state 1, which they could check with one final pulse to see if the atoms still glowed. Long story short, it appears that you can freeze a quantum state by measuring it continuously. Further studies have claimed successful observation of the quantum Zeno effect, including various studies of atomic energy levels, as well as the freezing of quantum tunneling, the same phenomenon that allows particles to teleport out of nuclei during nuclear decay. It's even been proposed that the quantum Zeno effect plays a role in the photochemical reactions that give birds their ability to see magnetic fields, something we've talked about before. So, there we have it. The quantum Zeno effect verified. Well, not quite. A flurry of papers came out after that 1990 result, disputing the claim on various grounds, and the arguments have continued. But I want to highlight one particular point. The physicist Leslie Ballantyne argues that it's not the abstract act of measurement that causes the quantum Zeno effect, but rather it's the physical consequence of interacting with the system, in this case hitting the atoms with a laser pulse. Ballantyne's objection really gets to the foundations of quantum mechanics. What exactly do we mean by a measurement, and what do we mean by wave function collapse? Well, let's start with measurement. It's never possible to perform a measurement without interacting with a system. And that interaction has consequences beyond just increasing our knowledge. If the measurement interaction is subtle enough, then you might hope to gain that info without perturbing the system too much. Ballantyne showed, on theoretical grounds, that each laser photon perturbed the system in such a way that the electron has an increased chance to jiggle back to its starting location. And he showed that to achieve a true quantum Zeno-like freezing, you'd need to hit the atom with many, many photons, and that was certainly not a subtle measurement. Recently, a group of researchers from Washington University claimed to have proved that it is perturbation, not measurement, that causes the quantum Zeno effect by demonstrating that with the right type of jiggling, a quantum transition could be forced to speed up rather than to freeze in what's called the anti-Zeno effect. Another way to think about measurement is in terms of how much information it extracts from the system. The idea is that measurement causes wave function collapse because it scrambles the delicate information connecting the different parts of the superposition. Superpositions only exist if the different parts of the wave function are connected or correlated with each other. We could say that the wave function for different electron states or quantum arrow positions are in phase with each other, or coherent. But that coherence is easy to mess up. Any interaction causes information to quickly spread into the environment. Decoherence occurs, and the different parts of the wave function representing different possible realities can no longer interact. In fact, as argued by Ballantyne, you can force a quantum system back to its starting state without true decoherence, but to get a full quantum Zeno effect, a perfect freezing of your electron or quantum arrow, you need to perfectly measure it, and that means decoherence, or the illusion of wavefunction collapse. So, onto wavefunction collapse. In the Copenhagen interpretation, only the part of the wavefunction corresponding to the measurement outcome survives. But in the many worlds interpretation, the entire wavefunction survives and splits, and you split with it. Obviously, we've talked about decoherence and many worlds before, but let's talk about what the quantum Zeno effect looks like in this picture. The effect should still exist because many worlds gives the same predictions as Copenhagen, but in this case, you're not forcing the wave function to collapse back to its starting position through the power of observation. Your interaction with the wave function causes it to decohere, which means two things. You perturb the system in a non-subtle way, for example, by forcing the electron or quantum arrow out of its superposition. In many worlds, that means generating separate realities corresponding to the possible outcomes. If you do it right, you'll produce more worlds in which the system goes back to the starting state, and then you enter the world of the possible outcome states, again, most likely the starting position. But if your observation wasn't perfect, there'll be some worlds in which the final state is chosen rather than the starting state. Like I said, if someone shoots you with a quantum arrow, don't blink. The quantum Zeno effect appears to be very real, but its interpretation is still hotly debated. And perhaps some of this is just semantic. For example, how do we really define measurement and interaction? And what is the wave function collapse? But quantum Zeno experiments are difficult, and perhaps future brilliant tests will give us clues to unravel the deepest mysteries at the heart of quantum mechanics. So, now you know why a watched quantum pot never boils, and it's because you did watch. Space-time. Thanks to The Great Courses Plus for supporting PBS. The Great Courses Plus is a subscription, on-demand video learning service with lectures and courses from professors from top universities and institutions. Through your subscription, you'll get access to a library of lectures about anything that interests you, science, math, history, literature, or even how to cook, play chess, or become a better photographer. If you've enjoyed our recent series on time in general relativity and want to dig deeper, you should check out Mysteries of Modern Physics, Time, hosted by Dr. Sean Carroll. In the course, you'll explore everything from time in quantum mechanics to black hole entropy and learn what cutting-edge science has to say about the nature of time. To learn more, check out thegreatcoursesplus.com/spacetimepbs or click on the link in the description below to start your trial today. Last time we gave you an update on the crisis in cosmology, the tension between the expansion rate of the universe measured at the beginning of the universe with the cosmic microwave background and the more modern universe measured with supernovae. TLDR, the so-called Hubble tension, is getting stronger. Patrick Bryant offers some excellent clarification, pointing out that the CMB number isn't actually a measurement of the current rate of expansion, which of course it can't be because that light comes from the beginning of the universe. Instead, that measurement provides us with an enormous amount of information about the composition and expansion of the universe back then. We then use our cosmological models to predict what the expansion rate should be today. For example, based on the amount of matter and dark energy, we can figure out how much the expansion should have slowed or sped up. And the value we get is different from what we observe in the modern universe. The tension could therefore be resolved by finding an error in either the CMB or supernova measurements, but also by finding that one of the assumptions in the CMB calculation is wrong, which would force us to change our model of how the cosmos evolved. That would be the most exciting case, in my opinion. It might, for example, tell us that dark energy has changed over time, which might help us actually figure out what dark energy is. Max Graham asks how gravitational waves encode the distance that they've traveled. Well, I'm glad you asked. The intensity of light drops off with the square of the distance traveled. If you know the true brightness or luminosity, measuring the distance dimmed brightness lets you calculate that distance. Trouble is, you can't get that luminosity directly from light itself, but it's different with gravitational waves from merging black holes. The intensity or amplitude of those waves drops off with distance, not distance squared, but the important thing is that the amplitude of the wave is directly encoded in the frequency of the wave. As black holes spiral towards each other, the frequency of that last phase of the in-spiral is pretty uniquely determined by the so-called chirp mass, which is a combination of the masses of both black holes. But that chirp mass also determines the power that was radiated in gravitational waves during the in-spiral. So, measure the in-spiral frequency, and that gets you the power, which you can think of as the amplitude of the gravitational wave before it fades over distance. So then, the amplitude of the wave as we see it at Earth tells us how much distance the wave must have traveled. I said at the start of the episode that it's exciting for scientists to be proven wrong. Hidden Marty offers this correction. Scientists love when other scientists are proven wrong. Well, I've got to hand it to you, that's even more exciting, especially if the other scientists were ones saying that you were wrong. But the point is that scientists do celebrate and embrace wrongness for the way it helps point towards increasing knowledge. And it's really worth pointing out that this stuff is all aspirational. The tendency to re-question everything is hard baked into the scientific process. Scientists are wrong a lot, but their wrongness is self-correcting. Tumush says, "Ugh, cosmology, I can't be bothered with your crisis right now." Tumush, the beauty of science is that it brings us together. Its crisis is everyone's crisis. Whether it's a full-blown existential crisis, or just a little radiating Hubble tension in your neck from staring at too much supernova data, science is the great unifier.